4. Not have I gotten, but what I received. Only a sinner saved by grace. Let's all stand together as we sing. 3, 0, 4 together on that first. Not have I gotten, but what I received.
Church today, and October has arrived, and good to see you in church this morning. Had a wonderful, wonderful wedding on Friday with the Mormons, and have you heard from the happy couple? You have not.
Oh, my.
Nary a word. Imagine that, huh? And you know what that means? It means they're normal. All right? And that's good, and but a delightful time and a great job. Just a wonderful, wonderful ceremony and opportunity to a great, great family get married into.
Amen.
The Morelands, of course, we know the Morelands and the Combest family, and just a delightful time. And looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us this morning, and appreciate you being in church today. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you for another Lord's Day that you brought us to. Lord, and as the choir sang this morning, there's always something different in the air when it's Sunday. Lord, we know we get to gather together with the people of God, and Lord, we pray your blessing upon our gathering here this morning. I pray, Lord, that you'll be pleased with all that's said and done. Bless the music, our fellowship together, the giving of your tithe and our offering, and Lord, honor the preaching of your word today. May you meet with us and give us what we need on this Sunday morning, first Sunday morning of October 2015. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Written down in glory, and it's mine.
Oh yes, it's mine.
Yes. angels sing God's glory. A sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory.
And it's mine.
And it's mine.
Oh, yes, it's mine.
Yes, it's mine.
With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. In the book it's written, saved by grace, all the truth that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by his blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory.
And it's mine.
And it's mine.
Oh, yes, it's mine.
Yes, it's mine.
And the white robe angels sing a story. A sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory.
And it's mine.
And it's mine.
Oh, yes, it's mine.
Yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
There's a new name written down in glory. 287, let's sing that together. Look to the Lamb of God. If you from sin are longing to be free, look to the Lamb of God. 287, let's sing that first and last together. On that first. If you from sin are longing to be free, look to the Lamb of God. He to redeem you died on Calvary. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For he alone is able to save.
Some announcements for us. Listen carefully, if you would, please. Our regular schedule today, and that is 5:30. We have a Christian growth class that meets down in the conference room. And our lesson tonight at 5:30 is going to be getting along with people. Getting along with people. Probably nobody needs that class, but in case you might, 5:30 tonight in the conference room with your Bible, and we'll look and see what the Bible says, essay about that subject, all right? Tonight at 6:30 then, we'll be right back in here for evening service, and we invite you back for the Sunday evening service. Tonight's message is going to be a decision made the difference. A decision made the difference, and I think it'll be a help to you. Excuse me, be back in your place on Sunday evening. Now, this coming week on Saturday evening, we're going to have a hayride and a bonfire down at the Manning's place in London. If you're going to ride the bus down from church, we have a good number signed up. You're welcome to do that. I think their address is down there. Is it, Bob? Is it down there? Do you know?
No, but it will be.
Okay. And they'll have their address down there. If you choose to drive down, that's fine. We're going to be there at 6 o'clock. The bus will leave here at 5:30 sharp. Okay. What time will the bus leave church? 5:30, okay? That means if you get here at 5:30, you may catch us, you may not. Depends on how fast you can run. And you want to make sure you're here in plenty of time. We'll get loaded up. We'll leave at 5:30 and get things started down there at 6 o'clock. And if you have a chair, bring it. You know, one of those chairs that fold up real nice and go inside of a bag or something like that. Bring that along with you. We can use any chairs like that. Not recommending a folding chair or anything like that, but you can bring chairs with you. That will help us getting everybody situated down there, all right? And that'll be a great time on Saturday evening. Then 2 weeks from today, October 18th, there'll be Old Fashioned Sunday, all right? We are, without apology, an old-fashioned, independent Baptist church. And once a year, we dress the part. All right, so we dress up on that day in old-fashioned outfits, and It's a great, great time together. We'll have a dinner on the grounds that day, and there'll be a paper down to sign up for that and what you'll bring for the dinner afterwards. But it's a great Sunday, and we look forward to our old-fashioned Sunday. That's 2 weeks from today, all right? All righty. Ladies' Night Out. Remember, your night out is October the 19th on Monday evening, and there's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs as well. And just follow the directions it has on that for you for Monday night, October the 19th. Okay? Let's take a moment now. We'll welcome any guests we have with us in the service this morning. We're always pleased when people visit with us. And if you're visiting this morning and not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, we'd love to meet you. Find out who you are and where you're from. And just put your hand up in the air right now, if you would, please. And Bruce has some visitors with him right down here. This is Bruce Slabaugh. How about that? And spells a little differently, but we're related somewhere. I know we are. And Bruce comes to our U ministry on Friday night. And introduce your guests for us, Bruce. Good to have you with us today. Thank you. From? Okay, very good. Good to have you here this morning. God bless you, Jim, Tina. Thank you. All right. Anyone else here today for the very first time? We can meet you today. Looking to see. You got some kids back there raising their hand. And not sure if they're first-timers or not. All right. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we'd appreciate you doing that. That way we'll have a record of your visit with us this morning. A little bit, we have the offering. Just put the card in the plate if you would. And keep the pen as our gift to you for coming today. We're glad you're here. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
My life, my joy, my all.
6:4. 'Tis the grandest theme through the ages rung. He is able to deliver thee. Let's sing that first and last together. On the first, 'tis the grandest thing through the ages rung. Turn with me. 542. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word. Let's all stand together as we sing. 542 together. As we begin this, let's have the children go ahead and be dismissed for children's church. All right? 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Because Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Let's sing that last together. As you find your seats, when we get to the chorus, we're going to have the instruments drop out. Let's all sing that a cappella. On that last together. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
All right, you may be seated. Good singing this morning. Ushers will come and we'll get our offering now today. Give as the Lord has blessed and prospered you. We'll ask God's blessing on our giving this morning. Brother Wallace, lead us in prayer, please.
Let us pray. Father, we do thank you again for being such a great God to us. And Lord, we praise you. We honor you by coming and opening up your word and listening to what you have to say for us today. We ask that every cent that is given, that it be used to glorify your kingdom. May everybody be good hearers and good doers of what they hear. And we'll give you all the praise and thanks for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Won't you take your Bibles this morning for our scripture reading to Ecclesiastes chapter 4, please. Ecclesiastes chapter 4. We're going to read verses 9 through 12. Not a lengthy passage at all. We'll just read it in unison this morning. Verses 9, 10, 11, and 12. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's Word, Ecclesiastes chapter 4. And we'll begin together on verse number 9. Ready? Two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. Again, if two lie together, heat, but how can one be warm alone? And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. And let's pray, shall we? Father, we bow before you now in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for the Bible this morning, for giving us your words that we can have copies of it in our hand today. And Lord, we pray that you will make our hearts good ground that the Word of God can fall into and bring forth fruit in our lives this morning. I would pray, Lord, that you would help us to focus. I pray for the special now this morning that as it is sung that you would tune our hearts to your heart. And that, Lord, for the next 30 minutes or so, nothing else would enter our mind and capture our minds that would hinder us from hearing what you would want to say to each of us today. So, Father, have your will and way now, please. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
He left the splendor of heaven, knowing his destiny was the lonely hill of Golgotha, there to lay down his life for me. If that isn't love, the ocean is dry. There's no stars in the sky, and the sparrow can fly. If that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this. If that isn't love, even in death he remembered the thief hanging by his side. He spoke with love and compassion, then he took him to paradise. If that isn't love, the ocean is dry, stars in the sky, and the sparrow can fly. If that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this. If that isn't love.
Amen. Our Heavenly Father, we bow before you in prayer now, and we thank you for the great love that you have for us. And Lord, we do understand this morning that we love you because you first loved us. And Lord, I'm asking for your help now this morning as we open up your word and we look at the subject we're going to look at this morning. I pray for your help. Lord, I need your guidance and I need your unction today. And I pray for the people as they listen. Lord, I pray that your will be accomplished in each heart and life. And Lord, I pray that each of us would be careful to give our undivided attention to the only book you've ever written. And may your Holy Spirit have his way in our hearts. And I'll thank you in advance for what I believe you're going to do this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I read about a little boy who attended church for the very first time. After the service, his parents asked what he thought. And he replied, "Well, the music was good, but I thought the commercial was a little long." I hope the commercial won't be a little long for you today. But I want to talk to you a little bit today. This is Family Month, and I want to talk to you this morning about the benefits of belonging. The benefits of belonging. I think everybody needs a place to belong. A place that just fits you, like your favorite pair of blue jeans or the recliner at your house. Just a place that seems to be yours. And I don't think God made us to be isolated. I don't think God made us to be alone. In fact, when he made Adam, he looked at Adam and said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I'll make a helpmeet for him." I think God made it so our life would be about relationships with each other. That he didn't intend for us to go through it all by ourselves. And yet, there have been studies made, and one particular fellow I read this week, Vance Packard, called America a nation of strangers. And in his findings, he said that 4 out of 10 people experience intense loneliness in their life. Our American culture has produced people that really they feel like they can more closely identify with television characters that they watch every week than with their next door neighbor. Everywhere you look, there's signs that people are hungering, they're searching for the fellowship, for the community, for a sense of family, if you will, that I think God had intended for the church to provide. And they're looking for it in all the other places. Every week, a little lady, sweet old lady, waited in line at the post office to buy 2 stamps. One day, she got to the counter. The postal worker told her, "You know, you don't have to wait in line to buy stamps. There's a machine over there. You can get them out of the machine anytime you want in packages of 20. And the lady looked at him and responded, "I know that, but that machine won't ask me about my arthritis." We want to be connected. We want somebody to care about us. God made us that way. We're wired that way. Now, the Bible uses a lot of different metaphors to describe the church. But one of the ones we'll focus on this morning is something called a family. And we call it sometimes our church family. It's the way God intended it to be. And in fact, hold your finger there. We're going to come back to Ecclesiastes and deal with these verses we read this morning. But look over at Acts chapter 9. Would you look there, please, in the New Testament? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and then the book of Acts. And if you'll go to chapter 9, you have the conversion of Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus, you remember, was a great enemy of the church and was finding Christians and would arrest them and put them in prison. And he's on his way to Damascus to find Christians there when he encounters Jesus Christ. He has the light that shines above the light of the sun. It knocks him to the ground. He hears the voice from heaven, and of course he accepts Christ at that time, and his life is transformed. His life is changed. Now, he's blinded by his experience, and they lead him into the city, and they take him into a house on straight in the house of one called Judas, and meanwhile, God is going to talk to a Christian in Damascus named Ananias. And here's what God tells Ananias. Look at verse number 13. I'm sorry, let's go to verse number 12. He says, God is talking to Ananias. He has seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in, putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way. For he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake." So here's what Ananias did. Verse 17, he went his way. He entered into the house and putting his hands on him said, what's the next 2 words, church? Brother Saul. Wow. Wait a minute. They related? Huh? Not by family that way. But they were related now because they're both part of the family of God. And now he calls him Brother Saul. Ever see, get a chance? We had handshaking time and Dave Yoder came down and what did I say? Hey, Brother Dave, he's my brother. See? And he's my brother in Christ. We call each other brother and sister. That comes from the Bible. That's because we are a church family. Okay? And so he calls him Brother Saul and welcomes him into the family of God. Keep going to your right in your Bible. Go past Acts and then Romans and then 1st, 2nd Corinthians. And I want you to get all the way to the book of Ephesians.
Keep going. You'll hit 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, and then you'll come to the book of Ephesians. And notice Ephesians chapter 2, and look with me together at verse number 19. Ephesians 2 and verse 19. Are you there? Say amen. All right. Now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Now you're part of the household of God. You're part of the family of God. Now, maybe you, I hope you do, those of you who've been coming to church and you belong at Bible Baptist Church, you ought to feel like this is where you belong. And I don't know if you have a certain chair with your imprint in it or not, but and sometimes that doesn't always work so well, you know, but you get moved around some, but that's a good thing too. But you know, we have our, most of you know, and I like it, I'm not against it, but most of you have a place to sit. And it makes it easy on the pastor, actually, because I look to see if you're there. See, Carol Treadway has me all messed up today because she's way in the back and she's usually up here, and but she's got her grandsons with her, and so they want to sit in the back, and so that's where they are. But it's good to see you, by the way. And but you, several years ago, I think on a Wednesday night, it fell on April 1st. And some of you remember that night, and April 1st, and we come out for the service, and everybody changed where they sat. Everybody sat all over the place. And I haven't got over it yet, but I'm working on it. But it's you just, because it's just comfortable. It's where you belong. And you find your spot and you say, this is where we are. It's great. It's great to feel like you belong somewhere. And that you're part of something. And that you belong here. And Solomon wrote about that back in Ecclesiastes. That's what he was writing here in Ecclesiastes 4 when he made this statement in verse 9. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. And again, if two lie together, and they have heed. And how can one be warm alone? And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. So Solomon, in his wisdom, lets us know that two are better than one. Now I just want to briefly give you just three simple benefits of belonging to a church. Three simple benefits of belonging. And they're from Solomon and his words here in Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Number one is strength. Did you know belonging to a church family provides you with spiritual strength? It helps you. Again, Solomon discovered a principle that holds true for his period of time, all the way through our period of time, and on through until time shall be no more. And that is that none of us can do alone what all of us can do together. None of us can do alone what all of us are able to do together. And so there's strength in numbers. I was reminded of a Peanuts cartoon when Lucy walked into the room and demanded that Linus change the TV channel. And he says, what makes you think you can walk right in here and take over? And Lucy said, these five fingers do. She said, individually they're nothing. But when they're curled up and all together like this, she said, they're a force to be reckoned with. And in the next column, Linus looks at his fingers and he says, why can't you guys get organized like that? See, and by the way, you say, well, Pastor, in church, there's always a shortage of laborers. Yes, there are. But Jesus said it'd be that way. Jesus said, the harvest is plenteous, the laborers are few. So pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that'll send forth laborers into his harvest. And we're always praying for God to send more into the harvest. Listen, none of us can do everything, but all of us can do something. And that's what you think about when you're in the church. Not individually, any of us can do all of it, but together we could be a force to be reckoned with. You see? And that's what you have to keep in mind. The Church of Jerusalem in the book of Acts reminds me of this, does it not? When the day of Pentecost came, the Bible says they were all with one accord in one place. They were all in unity together and waiting as God had, Jesus had told them to do, for the promise of the Father, for the promise of the Holy Spirit of God coming in power upon them. And He did, and 3,000 people accepted Christ as their Savior in one day. By the way, not just 3,000 people, but 3,000 Jewish people accepted Christ as their Messiah that day. That's an incredible thing. But they found out what can happen when people work together. People with different backgrounds, people with different personalities, people with sometimes conflicting opinions will set those aside and say, let's work together for the cause of Jesus Christ. There's strength when that happens. And because they did, lives were changed and history was affected. The disciples understood that working together could do. Jesus chose 12 of the most unlikely men you'd ever find. And He put together zealots, He put together fishermen with tax collectors and all sorts of men from different backgrounds and different personalities. And He molded those 12 into a group, by the way, that later on they say, these that have turned the world upside down are come hither also. They were a force to be reckoned with. We follow their example, the same thing can happen. Amen? Whether you want to feed the hungry or bring people to church on a bus or knock on their door and give them the gospel or teach a Sunday school class or help in children's church, not one of us can do what all of us can do together. It takes everybody doing what we ought to do to accomplish it for God. That gives you the strength to do that. How many people do you think were brought to church on a church bus by people who don't belong to a church? How many people do you think got visited in the hospital this week by people who didn't belong to a church? How many Bible classes do you think got taught this week by people who don't belong to a church? You see, there's strength in the numbers. And you get spiritual strength by being together with the people of God. You'll do more for the cause of Christ with others than you'll ever do by yourself. All right? There's strength. The second reason that Solomon gives us here of the benefit of belonging is not only strength, but support. Support. Notice verse 10. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. You know what it's like to get knocked down? Now, I don't necessarily mean physically somebody decked you, though some of you may have experienced that. I mean spiritually to get the wind knocked out of you. To just really have something hit you hard, as we say. Knock you down. And you're going to have that. We all have troubles. Don't ever fall into Satan's trap and look at other people at church and think, man, if I had that guy's life, you have no idea what they live with. You have no idea the troubles that they have. There are people this morning who I know are here and they're singing the songs of God and they're smiling and they're saying good morning and it's glad to see you. And I know they're dealing with some unbelievable things in their life right now. And yet they're here and people are looking at them and saying, boy, I wish I had their life. If we all came forward and laid all our troubles and all our burdens on the altar, and you could see everybody's burdens, everybody's troubles, you know what you'd do? You'd go walk right up and pick your own up and say, I think I'll just keep what I have. I'll just keep what I have. We all have troubles. Job said this, yet man is born into trouble as the sparks fly upward. We're born for trouble. And we're all going to have it. You won't get by it. There was a chaplain who had a sign on his door that said, if you have troubles, come in and tell me about them. If you don't have troubles, come in and tell me how you do it. That's probably a good sign. Jesus said, in this world, you will have tribulation. That's trouble. And Jesus said, you're going to have trouble in this world. Because we're in the world, but we're not of the world. And so we will have trouble in this world. But Jesus says we can be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. Greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. And so I can have victory, and I don't have to live in the world. I can live above the world because Christ lives in me. So can you. Be of good cheer, he said. Jesus is all about helping people up. When Peter got out of the ship and began to walk on the water and he took his eyes off Jesus and began to look at the waves and the wind and the storm, what did Peter do? He began to sink, didn't he? And immediately he cried out, Lord, save me. And Jesus reached down and picked him up. Picked him up. And they were back in the boat. When a woman was taken in adultery, supposedly in the very act, publicly being humiliated for it, they wanted Jesus to throw the first stone. Instead, he reached down and wrote on the ground. The Bible doesn't say what he wrote, but whatever he wrote was convicting enough for all of those men that they all put their stones down and walked away. And then Jesus looked at that woman and he said, hey, where are your accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said a very wonderful thing. She looked at Jesus and she said, well, no man, Lord. Waiting to see if he was going to condemn her. And that's why Jesus replied to her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. What did Jesus do? Gave her a fresh start. There are many of you in this room who would testify that you thank God he gave you a fresh start. And maybe he gave you more than one fresh start. Because that's what Jesus does. He's there to help us. When he met Peter on the shores of Galilee after Peter had denied him and cursed and swore. Remember, he was cooking breakfast on the shore and he calls out to the men, and of course John recognized it was Jesus, and they jumped in the water and came on shore. In the quietness of that morning and just hearing the fire crackling and the fish cooking, and Jesus breaks the silence. Nobody says a word until Jesus breaks the silence and looks at Simon Peter and said, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? What would we have done? We'd have got a hold of Peter and said, what were you thinking? What were you doing? Why would you follow so far off? Why did you warm your hands at the fire? Why were you in that place? Why were you hanging around that crowd? Isn't that what we'd have done? Can I help you with something? You say, why didn't Jesus do that? I think this. Listen, first of all, Christ knew what the problem was. It was a problem of the heart. Because all sin has its origin in our heart. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Worst advice you'll ever get is follow your heart. You're going to be in trouble if you do that. So God says, listen, Jesus just said, lovest thou me more than these? He didn't condemn him. He didn't say, why'd you do this? And by the way, whenever you deal with someone who's done wrong and someone who sinned, whether it's your children or anybody else, you're wasting your breath to say, why'd you do that? Let me ask you a question. When you sinned this last week, why did you do it? You know why? Because you're a sinner. And I'm a sinner. We sin because we are sinners. Now, we don't want to, and as a believer, you don't have to, because we have the power within us not to. But he didn't go to there. He's going to help Peter. And he gets to the root of the matter, and he says, after each question, remember, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. All you have to do is turn the page of your Bible and get into Acts chapter 1, and they're having the prayer meeting in the upper room, and Peter's there. You get to Acts chapter 2, and when they get the crowd together, there's somebody who stands up to preach the Word of God to them. Who is it? Peter. Maybe some of the same crowd. Listen, we're not even 2 months away from when he denied him. Jesus was alive for 40 days on the earth after His resurrection, before His ascension, and then they prayed for 10 days in the upper room, 50 days later. And now He's preaching Christ to some of the same religious people that may have heard Him cursing and swearing just not even 2 months earlier and denying He even knew the Lord. But God used Him in a great way. That's the kind of support we're supposed to have for one another. That's the kind of support we're supposed to have one for another. Is this on? That's the kind of support we're supposed to have one for another. We're not, our job isn't to look at somebody and to figure out why God can't use them. Our job is to look at somebody and say, how can I help God to use you? I want God to use you. And you're going to say, well, yeah, but they've done this and they've done that. Does God have anything other than crooked sticks to use? God will use you and me. That's all He's got. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 6, bear ye one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. So there's times you come to church and you got burdens and you got troubles and you have problems. And listen, here's the place where you don't get kicked in the pants, but you get a helping hand. And you get somebody to encourage you. People wouldn't need, you know what? If people came to church and got the encouragement from the people of God and got encouragement from the Word of God and got encouragement from the songs of God, and you know what? They wouldn't need any outside support groups. The local church takes care of that. And that's the benefit of belonging. The benefit of carrying one another's burdens. When somebody falls down, you know what the other fellow does? Lift him up. Lift him up. You don't kick him when he's down. You don't look at him and say, oh, I knew that happened to you. I figured that was coming. Huh? No, you help him up. You help him up. The early church took care of each other. You read the first few chapters of the book of Acts, and the Bible says, neither was there any among them that lacked. If anybody needed something, if somebody said, well, it fall's coming on or winter's coming on and I don't have a coat, somebody else said, well, hey, I got two at home, I'll bring one in, you can have one of mine. They just took care of each other. That's what a church does. By the way, that's what they used to do in America, and there was no such thing as welfare. You know why? Because people belonged. And when you belong, there's benefits to belonging. And your church family took care of you. But when you abandon the church, then you rely on the government to take care of you. Our system of government, and you can read the quotes from the founding fathers. I think it was John Adams who said that, or Ben Franklin, one of the founders, they said that our system of government is only set up for a moral and religious people. If we ever cease to be a moral and religious people, it will not work. That's where we are. That's why it's not working. Because we've ceased to be that religious and moral people. And so there's benefit of strength to get more done. There's benefit of support you need to get through troubled times. Because when you get down, someone else is there to pick you up, okay, and help you. The third benefit of belonging that Solomon gives us here in Ecclesiastes 4 is spiritual warmth. Strength, support, and spiritual warmth. He says in verse 11, if two lie together, they have heat, but how can one be warm alone? I mean, you think about people living in the desert and nomadic style and living in tents. But you don't have to just lay out in the desert in the tent on a cold night to feel cold and alone. You can feel cold and alone in the midst of a bunch of people. We have many people like that in America. You know, anytime you get separated from the people of God and regular gathering with the people of God, did you know? You grow cold spiritually. You don't stay as warm for God, as hot for God as you ought to be? Now, go with me. Hold your finger there in Ecclesiastes. We may come back to that. But go to me the Old Testament or the New Testament book of Hebrews, will you? The book of Hebrews. And Hebrews chapter 10. Familiar verses to some of you, but for others it may not be. And I want you to look at them. Hebrews chapter 10. This gives us one of the reasons why we assemble together. Here the writer of Hebrews says in verse number 24, let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. When it says we're here to provoke unto love and to good works, we're exhorting one another. Literally, the word means we're here to stir each other up. We're here to stir us up to do something for God. And to stay hot for God. To not begin to go away. So when you miss, and somebody says, man, I missed you last week. Everything all right? Everything okay? Listen, because we're here to encourage you. We don't want you to grow cold. We want you to stay hot. A man had missed several Sundays, and the pastor went to visit him. This is back in the 1800s, early 1900s, and the man was sitting in his house, and he let the pastor in and led him to the room where he was sitting with two chairs in front of the fireplace. He sat in one chair, the pastor sat in the other chair, and they just stared at the fire that was burning in the fireplace. Without saying a word, the pastor picked up the fireplace tongs and he reached in and he grabbed one of those coals from the bottom of the fire that was glowing and red, and he just pulled it out and set it out on the hearth. Closed the grate and sat back down in the chair, and they just both sat there watching the fire and watching that coal that he took out of the fire that was red and glowing grow dimmer and dimmer till it wasn't even red anymore. It was grayish and growing cold. And at that, the man got up from his chair and turned to the pastor and he said, I understand, Pastor. I'll be back in church on Sunday. He got the illustration. You remove yourself from the assembling of yourself together, from those who are going to stir you up. When a fire begins to go a little down, you know what you do? You stir things up a little bit. And you see the flame begin to start again. That's what church is for. Church isn't just to comfort the afflicted, it's to afflict the comforted. You have to get stirred up. And so, listen, don't think that I don't need to be at church. No, we all need to be here. We either need to be here to comfort somebody who's afflicted, or we need to be here because we need to get afflicted because we're too comfortable. But we need to be in church. I want to be hot for God. I don't want to be cold. It's what we say when someone gets excited about things of God and in love with the things of God and wants to do something for God. We say, boy, they're on fire for God. Jesus said of John the Baptist, he was a burning and a shining light. And y'all went out to see him. Everybody likes to watch a good fire. Anytime there's a fire going on, if you follow the fire truck and you get to the scene, there'll be a crowd there to watch the fire. And if the church gets on fire and the church has some people that'll be on fire for God, there'll be people who'll come just to watch us burn. But we need each other for that to happen. You won't get that by yourself. Getting hot for souls or hot for missions and a warm heart for the things of God, you have to be faithful. You want to belong. Everybody needs a place where they belong. I think everybody needs a place when you arrive, somebody smiles and says, it's good to see you. Glad you're here today. Thanks for coming. Missed you last week or missed you Wednesday and make you feel at home. God doesn't just call us to believe. He calls us to belong. God doesn't just call us to believe. He calls us to belong. The Bible is a story of God building a family that's going to support and strengthen and stir one another up to love and good works for all eternity. And He created you and me to be a part of it. We're part of that. If you're a believer and you need a place of belonging and you know Christ as your Savior and you have followed Him in believer's baptism, then I can recommend a place for you to belong. Okay? But you understand, before you can belong to the church of God and to this church family, you have to belong to the family of God. You say, well, isn't everybody a Christian? No, not everybody's a Christian. Doesn't everybody belong to God's family? Not everybody belongs to God's family. Now, I want you to turn to one more scripture. Will you do that? Look at Galatians. You're in Hebrews. Go to your left, would you? Go to your left and go all the way back to Galatians. In Galatians chapter 3. Go past Timothy and Thessalonians and go past Colossians and Philippians and Ephesians and get to Galatians. Chapter 3. I want you to look at verse 26 with me, will you please? Galatians 3 and verse 26. The Bible says, "For ye are all the children of God." Well, there it is. It's in the Bible. We're all God's children. But the verse doesn't end there, does it? No, we have to read the rest of the sentence. The Bible says, "Ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus." You'd have to turn there, but St. John, Gospel of John 1 and verse 12 says, "But as many as received Him," that's Jesus, "to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name." He gave you power. God gives you power when you put your faith in Jesus Christ. He gives you a new birth. It's called a spiritual birth into His family. That's how you become a child of God, when you put your faith in Jesus Christ. And when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you become a child of God. You become part of God's family. But you have to understand that we've all sinned in the sight of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's a price that has to be paid for that sin. The wages of sin is death. All of us deserve to pay that wage for sin. We owe it. And we rightfully owe that debt. That death is separation from God in a place called hell. But God so loved you and me that He sent His only begotten Son to die on the cross in our place. The Bible says God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He died for me. He died for you. The songwriter said, "I should have been crucified. I should have suffered and died. I should have hung on the cross in disgrace, but Jesus, God's Son, took my place." And He took your place as well. 3 days later, He rose from the dead. God brought Him back from the dead. God was saying, "I'm accepting my Son's sacrifice for the sins of mankind." And God says, that's what we must do. That we must, by faith, accept Jesus Christ, and His payment for our sin as our hope for heaven. And then He gives us the gift of eternal life, and we shall be saved. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Eternal life, gift of God. How can I get eternal life? Go to church. Wait a minute. How can it be a gift if I got to earn it? If I got to do something to get it, it's not a gift. Well, how do I get eternal life? Oh, you got to get baptized. People will give you all kinds of answers of how you get eternal life, but God says it's His gift. And when it's a gift, I can't earn it. Gifts are given to you because somebody else earned it. Someone else paid for it. Well, eternal life is God's gift to us. If we don't pay for it, who did? Jesus Christ did when He died on the cross. That's why the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Getting that gift of eternal life is nothing you do. It's through what Jesus has done for you. You just have to accept it and receive Him as your Savior. You know what God does? He He puts you into His family. The close of our service every Sunday morning, we sing, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. And you become part of the family of God when you put your faith in Christ Jesus as your Savior. If you've never done that, you ought to do it this morning. You ought to trust Christ your Savior. If you're saved and you haven't been scripturally baptized, Lavella will come this morning. We spoke this week. Lavella's been saved and is trusting Jesus Christ her Savior, and said when she got saved that she was baptized. And I said, how did you get baptized? She said, they poured water on my head. I said, you understand that scripturally you have not been baptized. And she said, I'm understanding that. Mm-hmm. And we explained what baptism was. She's going to follow the Lord and obey Him in baptism today. Amen. And become a member. See, that's the way you ought to respond. Just the way she responded. Say, if that's what God says I should do, that's what I should do. If that's what God says I have to do to be part of His family, is receive Christ my Savior, I'm receiving Him as my Savior. That's what God says I have to do in order to go to heaven and not go to hell, I'm going to trust Jesus Christ. Ask Him to save me. And the step of obedience and belonging, it's all part of what you do. And once you belong to God's family, then you ought to belong to a church family. Because there's many benefits to belonging. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you, Lord, for a great salvation that you provided in Jesus Christ as your gift to us. Thank you for the church and a church family that you provide for us, that we receive strength and we receive support and we receive spiritual warmth. Father, I pray that you'd help us appreciate the benefits of belonging. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I'm going to finish the prayer in just a moment. But right now, just between you and God this morning, no one looking. I wonder how many folks in the room would say, Pastor, there's a time in my life when I realized that I was a sinner who needed a Savior. And I realized that Jesus was the Savior I needed. And Pastor, there's a time in my life when I did receive God's gift of eternal life, and I've received Jesus as my Savior. And if I died this morning, I know for sure that I'd go to heaven. Here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? Just say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved today. God bless you. You may put them down. Is there somebody here today and would say, Pastor, I never knew that anybody could know. Maybe you never knew anybody could be sure that they're part of the family of God, that they would receive God's gift of eternal life and a promise that they'll be in heaven one day. And you say, Pastor, I heard it for the first time today, and I'm not sure if I died I'd go to heaven, but I'd like to be sure, and I'd like to pray for you. I'm not going to call you out. No one's going to embarrass you, but I'll just remember you in prayer. Would you slip your hand up and say, Pastor, remember me in prayer this morning? I'm not sure about where I'd spend eternity. God bless you. Is there anybody else? Say, Pastor, pray for me. I'm not sure about my salvation. I don't know that I've ever received Christ as my Savior. Pray for me. I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, I understand the benefits of belonging. And the Lord has spoken to my heart about appreciating the benefits of being part of a church family. And Pastor, God spoke to me this morning. Would you pray for me? Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Yes. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray. And we'll have our invitation. When I'm done praying, then we'll stand to our feet. The pianist will play. Brother Bob will sing. And as soon as that happens, if God has spoken to your heart, Christian, you want to come and pray and thank God for belonging to a church family, come and pray. If you're here today, maybe you're today like Lavella and you need to be scripturally baptized. Maybe you've never been saved. We have people who have been trained. They'll take a Bible and show you how you can know Christ as your Savior. If you're saved and you've never been scripturally baptized, come and say, I need to be baptized. We have everything necessary, everything you need to be baptized and obey the Lord this morning. If you're saved and you're scripturally baptized and you say, Preacher, I think this is where we ought to belong and we want to serve the Lord here, then you come and we'd welcome you into the family that's called Bible Baptist Church. Heavenly Father, have your way now in this invitation. May your will be done, please, in every heart and life. Thank you for hands that have been uplifted, indicating you've spoken to their heart. I pray that no one would leave this morning without knowing they have the gift of God, which is eternal life through Jesus Christ. And that no one would leave today without understanding the wonderful benefits of belonging to the family of God and to the church of God. So have your way in this invitation now. May each one do what you're telling them to do in their heart. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this morning. Will you please?
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only always living in me.
Go ahead and be seated for a minute if you would. I mentioned we have Lavella Dyke coming this morning. Lavella has received Christ as her Savior, and she wants to follow the Lord in baptism this morning. And God bless you, Lavella. That's a great decision. You go with Mrs. Wallace right down the back steps here, and she'll get you outfitted and ready to go. All right. That's great. Just a few weeks ago, John was saved and baptized, her husband, and now she's following the Lord today. Isn't that good? Praise the Lord. And Lavella was badly burned in a fire, and she's just a miracle of God's grace already. And it's just exciting to see her and John following the Lord. And both of them facing some physical issues and such, but she told me they started reading the Bible about 5 years ago, searching. And they had a neighbor across the street, the Mrs. Johnson, who went to Bible Baptist Church, if I remember right, like 40 years ago. And she told him to go to Bible Baptist Church. Aren't you glad we're still here? Amen. And still preaching the same thing she remembers 40 years ago? And what a blessing. And so you keep them in prayer as they grow in the Lord, all right? Okay, Brother Bob, you come, and we'll get ready for baptism.
All right, let's do some favors this morning. Some favors we haven't done for a while. Wow, we got the trio going on. All three of you have your hands raised. Does that mean you're doing a trio this morning? Of course? No. Oh, okay. Elijah, what you got? Number 11. All right. It's one of my favorites as well. He is mine. Number 11. Let's sing that first together. Long before the sing it now. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power, wonder-working power in the blood. Let's sing that first together. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Higher ground. On that first together, I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Yes, sir. 244. 244. Hold the fort, for I am coming. This is a great one. On that first 244, oh, the comrades see the signal waving in the sky. Reinforcements now appearing, victory is high. Hold the fort, for I am coming. See the signal through, wave the answer back to heaven. By thy grace, Carol? 56. The old rugged cross. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. On that first together. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. The emblem of suffering and shame.
Artificial leg. that doesn't bend backwards very well, so we let her sit down and we'll baptize her that way.
Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Amen. This is Lavella Dyke. And Lavella, upon a public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to His command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, and raising the likeness of Jesus. Amen. The servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen. All right. Well, let's do a couple more favors. Wow. Okay, Gene. Number 10. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. All right.
All right, let's stand together, shall we? Appreciate your attention, and isn't it great to see somebody obey the Lord and not let anything stop them? That's a blessing. Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us and for giving us a good service together here today. Lord, thank you for meeting with us. Thank you for Lavella and her faith in Christ and her obedience to you in baptism. And Father, I pray that you'd be mindful of us now, Lord, as we leave this place and help us to be aware of your presence with us. I pray you'll give us a good afternoon and bring us back tonight for the evening services. And we prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Jointed with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.